So hi dear students, welcome to the video lecture series of ME402 Design of Machine Elements 2. So we'll be starting with your module 6 and this being your lecture 1. So as far as your module 6 is concerned, we'll be mainly dealing with two important topics, which is the design of connecting rod. And I hope you guys know what a connecting rod is. The second important topic is the design of pressure vessel, and again you know what a pressure vessel is, right? We have already learned the design of rivets in a pressure vessel, right? So under this connecting rod, we'll be learning about the material selection, then the design of different parts like a connecting rod shank, then small end and big end, connecting rod bolts, and finally we'll be learning about the inertia bending stress occurring inside this connecting rod. Now under this pressure vessel, we'll be mainly dealing with thick cylinder and thin cylinder equations, followed by a comparative study between the open and closed cylinder. Okay, this is it. This is the complete module. Okay, now let us go in detail. Okay, let us start with the design of a connecting rod. Okay, so from the name itself, it is pretty much clear that it is connecting something, right? Connecting rod. It is connecting something, right? And it is a rod shaped something, right? Now, so what exactly is it connecting? Okay, so a connecting rod is actually a connecting device or a connecting equipment which is connecting the piston with the crankshaft. To be exact, it is connecting the piston pin to the crank pin. Okay, so you yourself can see this in the figure. Right. So what is the function of a connecting rod? Okay, so actually the first important function is that it connects. Okay, so why do we want to connect? That is the next question. Okay, now the basic function of a connecting rod is to transmit the push and pull forces from the piston pin to the crank pin. Right. So the basic function of a connecting rod is to transmit the push and pull forces from the piston pin to the crank pin. So what kind of forces? Actually, inside the piston, a reciprocating motion occurs, right? This reciprocating motion needs to be converted to a rotatory motion in the crankshaft. Okay, so it actually facilitates the conversion of this reciprocating motion to the rotating motion. Okay, and in meanwhile, it also transfers the lubricating oil from the crank pin to piston pin. Okay, now another interesting factor about this connecting rod is that it is actually manufactured, even though it looks like a different parts, it is actually manufactured as a single unit. Okay, and that too by drop forging. And after manufacturing, it is actually cut into two pieces and then it is machined appropriately, and then bolt and nut is it is assembled using bolt and nuts. Okay, so it is actually made by deep forging, right? Now let us go in detail about with the connecting rod. Now before going in further detail, it is very very much important to know the different parts of a connecting rod. Okay, so one of the important part is the middle section, which is actually an I section. Okay, and that I section or the middle length portion is actually called the shank of a connecting rod. Okay, so the next important portion is the top portion, which is shown in the figure. It is actually called the big end. Okay, it is actually the big end, right? From the figure itself, it is pretty much clear that it is the big end. Okay, then the next opposite portion, it is the small end. Okay, obviously it is a small end, right, with a smaller diameter. Okay, now this small end is actually connected to the piston and the big end is connected to the crankshaft using the nut and bolt arrangement, right? So you have three important portions are over, that is shank, big end and small end. And the next important component of a connecting rod is the bolt and nut arrangement. So in short, there are four important components to be designed. One is a shank, followed by big end, followed by small end, and which is again followed by bolt and nuts. Okay, now another factor is that related to the connecting rod is that the connecting rod is one of the highly stressed region or a highly stressed part of an IC engine. Why so? Because it is actually transmitting a high force which is generated by the power stroke to the crankshaft, Okay, so it is continuously delivering this force. Okay, and hence it is one of the highly stressed part in an IC engine, and therefore it is actually the material used for its manufacturing is actually medium carbon steel or alloy steels. Okay, now with this basic information, let us go into the design. But before going to the in detail about the design, you should know what is actually the failure criteria, or how does the failure occur, or the proposed way in which the failure can occur in a connecting rod. Okay, so as you can see, there is a connecting rod in the figure. Okay, now a connecting rod is having pretty much longer length, right? And it is actually from the working itself, it is very much clear that it is subjected to compressive forces, right? The force from the piston is transferred to the crankshaft, right? So in a way, a compressive force is acting on the piston. Okay, so it is having a pretty much longer length, and then it is subjected to a compressive force. So this can be considered as a column, and because of which the failure occurring is due to buckling. Okay, similarly, we have already learned in mechanics of solids, buckling, failure by buckling of columns, right? The same concept can be applied over here also. Okay, now an interesting thing is that the buckling can occur in two different ways. From the cross section, it's an I section, so if you mark one as an x axis and the other one as a y axis, you can pretty much see that it can fail in two ways, one with respect to the x axis and the other one with respect to the y axis. Okay, the figure shows the possible ways of failure. Okay, the first figure shows one type of failure, and the second figure actually shows the second way in which it can fail. Okay, so one along one axis, and the second failure is along the different axis, right? Now to get more clarity, we can just see one more diagram. Okay, here the two types of failures is shown. The A figure A shows one type of failure, and the second shows the second type of failure. Okay, in two different directions, and the cross section is an I section, and the x axis and y axis is marked over there, right? Okay, now another interesting factor is that a connecting rod in the from the figure A, just if you look at the figure A, it is actually in that direction, in that particular plane, it is connected in a hinged condition. Okay, you can see that the kind of attachment towards the end is actually a hinged condition. Okay, so if you have any doubt, you can just go to YouTube, or I'll paste the link. Okay, I'll share the link with you guys. Okay, now you can see that the first condition, that A figure A is actually a hinged condition, whereas the figure B is a fixed condition. Okay, now coming to the first kind, that is a hinged condition. In a hinged condition, the failure actually occurs, the buckling failure occurs as per the Euler's buckling equation, right? And that is given by P is equal to pi square EIXX by L square. Okay, since it is a hinged condition, the effective length is actually the length of the beam itself. Okay, now but when it comes to a fixed condition, that is the second case, in the figure B, you can see that the buckling failure occurs, the same equation can be applied, but when it comes to a fixed end, you have already learned that when it comes to your effective length becomes L by 2, right? Or you can see that your crippling load P becomes 4 times pi square EI by L square. Okay, so on comparing these two, we can see that your IXX must be equal to 4 times IYY, that is the moment of inertia with respect to the x-axis, must be equal to 4 times the moment of inertia with respect to y-axis to make this equally strong. Okay, it should not fail in any of the direction, in both the directions it should not fail. If it should not fail, if the objective is that it should not fail in both the direction, then the essential condition is that your moment of inertia with respect to x axis must be equal to 4 times the moment of inertia with respect to y axis. Okay, therefore the dimensions of the section should be chosen in such a way that it obeys this condition. Okay, so based on that, the I section dimension is chosen, and the I section dimension is as follows. Okay, so basic thickness is taken as T, and the remaining dimensions are taken with respect to this T. Okay, so you can see from the figure how it is taken. The width is taken as 40 and the height is taken as 5T. Okay, and the basic thickness is T. Now if we can solve this, or you can find the moment of inertia with respect to x-axis and moment of inertia with respect to y-axis, it will be approximately, your ixx will be approximately equal to 4 times iyy. This is the best possible way in which the I section dimensions can be taken. When you're coming to a connecting road, you can see that the center it is actually an I section, and the I section dimension, the variation of dimension is something like this, where T is the thickness and the whole other dimension is in relation with the thickness of the I section. Okay, thank you. And this is the basic concept related to a connecting road. Okay, with this basic understanding, we can go to the designing phase. And regarding these diagrams and all, these dimensions and all, and dimensions plus the other necessary equations and all those things are actually there in your data book. You can refer that. This diagram is also there in this data book. You can refer to that. And I'll mention all these things in the coming lectures. Okay, thank you.